With a comb over?
With hair.
With hair.
He had like five times as much hair as he has now. Yes, that's what I'm saying. Like there was a lot of hair.
Was it that long ago?
I've been bald all my life.
All right, let's get started. Let's get started because we're already running late. Let's start with a word of prayer. Okay. Father, I just thank you so much just for a night where we can come out and just study this amazing letter, just a short letter that you and your spirit have maintained and preserved for almost 2,000 years so that we can get here tonight and we can read it and we can study it and we can think about it and we can see the beauty in it and see the beauty in what Paul was writing, but most of all, see the beauty in your salvation, in your gospel. So, Father, give us just a good understanding of this letter to the Galatians, and let us have a good time tonight with this. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Before we start, I wasn't sure. I ran off about 10 copies, 8 copies, I think, of the letter to the Galatians. So if you want a copy, here's what I want y'all doing. I want to talk through the letter each week, each Wednesday night. And then I want you reading through the letter as many times as you can throughout the week. You know, take notes. That's why I print them out for you. And I've got more. We can print out more if you would like some. But just to be able to go through it and to just chew on it and think through and write notes out and do all whatever you need to do and whatever you want to do with that. So that's my encouragement, is that as we study, like tonight we're doing Galatians, for the rest of the week, you just read through it. 3 or 4 times, take notes, write stuff in here, just sort of tear that piece of paper up. That way you're not writing notes all crazy everywhere, all over your own Bible, personal Bible, and you can come back later if you want to do that. But that is that. Do you may need more copies of it?
I got 2 extra.
You have 2 extra? Okay.
She was trying to hold out on me and so I didn't have one.
There we go. But that's, like I said, those are yours, so you can do it as you want.
I like to make sure.
All right, so let's start thinking through this letter, and I believe, this is my opinion, others would disagree with me. I have my reasons why I think this was the first letter written. It ties into that Jerusalem Council really well, which is in between the first and second missionary journey, because it deals with the issue that they were dealing with, and I'll explain that here in a little bit, but that's why I place it here. Some people place it later on. Even after all the other letters, that it's one of the last letters, which I can't see the logic in that, so I won't go there. It's not really that important. You don't really care that much. So, the central theme of Galatians is the freedom that we have in Christ. And Paul is going to try and sell this and push this and argue for this over and over and over and over again. In some ways, it's somewhat similar to the Hebrews. That's why I do not think Paul wrote the letter to the Hebrews. My personal opinion is Barnabas did, but that's just me. I can't prove it, but you can't prove me wrong. So I think Barnabas wrote it because it was a letter of encouragement and a letter encouraging the church, saying, let us do this and let us do this. But that's neither here nor there. It's similar to Hebrews in that it's making similar arguments, all right? But it makes very different, goes about it in different ways. That's why I don't think Paul wrote this and wrote the letter to the Hebrews, because it just, they're two different lines of thought. I just don't think he would have done that. So, all right. All right, Galatia, where is it? We got a map? Anybody got their Bible with a map? Kind of right in the middle of Turkey, right? You don't want your phone tonight, right? That's what I thought. My son is back there doing stupid things, so I've been ignoring him until I just got tired of that. Caden, seriously, go to Bible study now. I think it's where he was going with Iconium, Lystra, Derbe. I think some of those were Galatian. It's right on the border of Galatian type cities, and so that region is right there in the middle of Turkey. So that's where we're aiming. I believe it's where he went on his first and second and also on his third missionary journeys. So it's a region he was very familiar with. But again, it has that tone of that Jerusalem Council time when he's arguing, hey, You know what? These guys don't have to follow the Old Testament law. They don't have to do all that stuff, which we'll get into. All right. Look at, it starts off, Paul. How does he identify himself? Right there. Paul what? An apostle. What is an apostle? I stumped you on the first one. Comes from the Greek word apostello. Stello means to send or to turn out. All right. Apo means away. All right. So to send away, one who is sent out and sent away. In the Latin, we would use the term missionary. Okay. That's the more of the Latin term. It's missionary. The Greek term is apostello or apostle. And so it's someone who was sent out. So Paul saw himself as one who was sent out. In the 13 letters that we believe he wrote, nine times he identifies himself as an apostle of my Lord Jesus Christ. I think twice he says I'm a slave, once he says I'm a prisoner, right? But apostle is the one he uses the most in here. You can see Paul an apostle not from men or by men, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father. Why is that a crucial distinction? He's one sent out. Who sent him out? Jesus and God did. He makes it very clear. No man sent me here. God sent me here. All right. God the Father who raised him from the dead. And all the brothers who are with me. All right. We get a couple of different things. Timothy's on, I think, 7 of the letters. Silvanus, or Silas probably, is on 2 of them. We get one guy named Sosthenes is in another letter. But this one, he just says, the brothers who are with me. I think for that reason, I think it was written from Antioch, from Syrian Antioch, because that's where sort of the headquarters was. And so I think he goes on the first missionary journey, comes back, and in the meantime, we know the Judaizers come up and sort of taint the message, and he gets wind of this. I think he goes to Jerusalem, has the Jerusalem Council, where they decide, no, they don't need to follow all that, but they need to follow no sexual immorality, none of the food sacrificed to idols kind of a thing. Let's send the letter back. I think he's in Antioch, and he's got this letter in his hand, and he says, I'm going to write the churches in Galatia, and they'll get this letter before I get there to them, or I will take this letter to them so they understand what was discussed and what was brought up at the Jerusalem Council. All right? That's my theory. I can't prove all that, but I can prove a little bit of it. So, all right. Verse 3 starts, grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Remember, we've talked about this. It's always God the Father. It's always the Lord Jesus Christ in Paul's letters, in Luke's writings, all right, because Luke is going to pick up on whose writings? Paul. I mean, they're going to share a vocabulary in a lot of ways. So whenever you read Luke, you should hear Paul. They're always going to be similar because they're always together, all right? Grace and peace. Always. This is the common greeting. Alright? It's like saying, hey, what's up? Alright? It's just a very common greeting. Grace to you and peace. Who gave himself for our sins to rescue us from the present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. And here's where we get to the rub of the whole letter right here in 6. 6:1-6 says this, I am amazed that you are so quickly turning away from him who called you by the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel. Not that there is another gospel, but there are some who are troubling you and want to change the good news about the Messiah. Now, who are these some? Who are these some who are troubling them and wanting them to change the good news? This is, again, this is the Judaizers. This is where it rolls right into that Jerusalem Council. Later on, they're identified as false brothers trying to take away their freedom, right? So you see this theme that goes through it. It's as if he goes on the first missionary journey, and these guys come behind him and go, oh, Paul told you you just had to accept Christ, you had to believe in Jesus. Yeah, there's also this. And you can see that in Acts 15:1, right? You can't just believe. You also have to be circumcised. You have to start following dietary laws. You have to start doing this and this. And that's why Paul got so upset and said, I demand this Jerusalem Council in Acts 15. Because he hated the fact that they were doing this to him. And so that's why I believe, again, that he writes this letter. Because he's saying, why are you turning away from the simple message that I told you and listening to these guys who are telling you you got to get circumcised and follow this law and this law and this law? Okay, so that's the rub of the Galatians letter, and that's the argument he's going to make all the way through this. Okay, all right. Let's see, pick up verse 8. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you another a gospel other than what we have preached to you, a curse be on him. That's the word anathema. All right, anathema on him. As we have said before, I now say again, if anyone preaches to you a gospel contrary to what you received, a curse be on him. For am I now trying to win the favor of the people or God? Or am I striving to please people? If I'm still trying to please people, I would not be a slave of Christ. Okay? Now, he launches into a little bit of a thing where he says, this is where I got my gospel from. Because he said what? You are turning away from the gospel to another gospel. And he says, let me validate my gospel. Let me validate that. So in 11, he takes off. Now, I want you to know, brothers, that the gospel preached by me is not based on human thought, for I did not receive it from a human source, and I was not taught it, but it came by a revelation directly from Jesus Christ. Okay? Now, when did he get all that? You see, what's interesting is Acts 9, you know, we had the conversion of Saul, and then he says, and then I was in Damascus, and then I went to Jerusalem, and what they don't say is that was about a three-year period where he went into the desert. And that's what he discusses here. All right. 13 says, For you have heard about my former way of life in Judaism. I persecuted God's church to an extreme degree and tried to destroy it. I advanced in Judaism beyond many contemporaries among my people because I was extremely zealous for the traditions of my ancestors. But when God, who from my birth set me apart and called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son in me so that I could preach him among the Gentiles, I did not immediately consult with anyone. What's he saying? What's he saying there? I didn't go consult with anyone when I first got saved. So my gospel is what? It's not from man. This is the point he's trying to make. 17, I did not go up to Jerusalem to those who had become apostles before me. Instead, I went to Arabia and came back to Damascus. Now, what's in Arabia? Sand. Sand is there, all right? He went into the desert, all right? And it's about a three-year process. He just went into the desert. He went away. He got away from all this and came back to Damascus, where we know he spent time with the disciples. Y'all, come on in. Come on in. All right? Verse 18 says, then after 3 years, I did go up to Jerusalem to get to know Cephas. Who's Cephas? Good. That's an easy one, all right? Means a little stone, all right? If you think of a stone fireplace, one of the little rocks in the stone fireplace, that's what Peter stands for, all right? Just a little one, all right? I went to get to know Cephas, and I stayed with him for 15 days. But I didn't see any other apostles except James, the Lord's brother. Now, I'm not lying in what I write to you. God is my witness. Afterward, I went to the region of Syria and Cilicia. Now, what's in Cilicia? Y'all remember? It's where the freedmen synagogue, they were part of Alexandria and then Cilicia. Well, Cilicia is where Tarsus is from. And if you remember in Acts, it says he went up to Tarsus and he spent probably 10 years there. All right. I went to the region of Syria and Cilicia. I remained personally unknown to the Judean churches in Christ. They simply kept hearing, he who formerly persecuted us now preaches the faith he once tried to destroy, and they glorified God because of me. So evidently they were getting reports back. And this is Paul. Paul is making the argument here in this is my gospel. It didn't come from Peter. You see, I went to Arabia. I went to Damascus. And then after 3 years, I went and hung out with Peter. And I hung out with him for like 2 weeks with he and James. So what's he saying about his gospel if he's making that declaration? That I did not start off here. I just came and visited them after a while. Right? It's like I went to seminary and then I hung out with my friend for 2 weeks. Would you then say, oh, well, that's where he got his gospel, that 2 weeks with Peter? Well, no, that's crazy. It's those 3 years in Arabia and that time in Damascus where he was getting all of his gospel. So when he goes and he teaches the Galatians, this is the gospel of Christ. He's got some valid some valid points here. As opposed to those who come behind him, who got all of their gospel from the Pharisees, from the law, from the scribes and all those people. Okay, so that's the contrast he's trying to make there. Two keeps rolling through this thing. If you're doing this chronologically, you get the first missionary journey would be in between chapter 1 and chapter 2, which says then, verse 2, verse 1 says, then after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas, taking Titus along also. Titus is one of my favorites, okay? Yes?
You may have said this when
go ahead.
I was talking.
Like that's okay.
I should have been talking. That you're saying that he's saying when he spent his 3 years, I think it's what you're saying, that he was just praying and going over the scriptures and that this was like, in other words, him and God.
Well, he claims, I got my gospel as a revelation from Christ.
And not just his revelation on the road, but 3 years of revelation.
Well, he's saying, I received it from Christ. He also says, I spent 3 years in Arabia and Damascus.
Yeah, but he never
says. So those are two concurrent things he claims. I'm going to assume they're the same thing. Mm-hmm. That I received my discipleship while I was in Arabia and Damascus.
Because I've heard it preached before that he and Jesus spent 3 years together.
Well, this is the best biographical account we have of Paul's early life. This is it. This is all we get right here. And it's all we know.
So that verse is as much as we know about what he did for those 3 years.
That's it. It's all we know. We know we have two concurrent statements of Christ gave me the gospel, and I spent 3 years in Arabia and Damascus, and I got to put the two together and go, I don't know when or how or whatever, but I know those two things happened, and I would assume they were concurrent. But that's an assumption. I think it's a safe assumption to make, though. Mm-hmm. Okay? All right. So, first missionary journey. Remember this one? We go around Pisidian Antioch. We do sermons. Iconium. We get run out of town. Lystra. Get stoned almost to death. Hobble ourselves out of town. Go to Derbe. All right? Again, this is a Galatian city. All right? Turn around and go back to the cities again. Come back. The Judaizers come behind them. You got to be circumcised. You got to follow the law. You got to do all this stuff. Paul says, whoa. We need to sit down and figure this out. This is this 2:1. After 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem, the Jerusalem Council, with Barnabas, taking Titus along also. Like I said, Titus is one of my favorites. When you think about Paul, does he seem to have a strong personality? Does Paul come across as a strong person? Does he seem like a needy person at all? Does Paul need anybody? Yes or no?
He really liked Timothy.
He did like Timothy, but would you ever say, well, Paul, he just depended on Timothy. He just needed to be with Timothy.
Because he would send people away and get up and leave on his own.
Titus is the one character that I think has a lot of independence to him. And this is one scenario we'll see. Also later on, Paul sends him to Corinth, which is a pretty rough town with a really tough letter. And he's missing, and the whole point of 2 Corinthians is being in the ministry is really hard. Mm-hmm. And Titus is one guy I rely on, and he wasn't there. Because he went to see you guys in Corinth, and he was supposed to meet me in Troas, and I was broken. I was hurting, and I was missing Titus. And I longed to see Titus. So I went on to Macedonia. I went on to Philippi. And finally, God was gracious enough to bring Titus to me. And it's this moment where Paul doesn't really express that with anybody else, but he does with Titus. And Titus always gets the hardest jobs. Right? The letter to Titus, he's in Crete, where they're all liars and gluttons and all this stuff. He sends him to Dalmatia at one point, which is sort of the Balkan area, Yugoslavia, which in that time was barbarians, to say the least. So I always picture Titus as the guy, he's got the motorcycle jacket on, he's all tatted up. He's just like, oh yeah, I'm a Christian. Let's go preach the gospel to somebody. He's the guy that would be preaching under the bridge, all right? Just that type of personality, all right? So we go to the Jerusalem Council, and how do you think you walk into that? You got Peter, you got James, you got John, you got all the apostles there in Jerusalem. All the really super Christians are there, and Paul comes in with Barnabas, and he's got Titus with him. And the whole point is, should these people be circumcised? And look at the text. After 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas, taking Titus along also. I went up according to a revelation and presented to them the gospel I preached among the Gentiles, but privately to those recognized as leaders, so that I might not be running or have run the race in vain. Verse 3 says, but not even Titus, who was with me, though he was Greek, was compelled to be circumcised. Right? So even there, they're going, you know, you really should be circumcised. I mean, this, if you're going to be a Christian, if you're going to be a follower of Christ, that's a Jewish sect. You should probably... And Titus is going, nah, I'm good. Nah, it doesn't affect him at all. I mean, he's sitting in a room with all the super Christians, all these Jewish men, prominence, pedigree, all this stuff, and he's going, nope, Jesus is enough. That's it. I'm good. And it's just this boldness that he had. That's why I just really love Titus, because he's just the tough guy. Verse 4 says, the issue arose because of false brothers. Remember those Judaizers? Smuggled in, who came in secretly to spy on, and here's the big word, on the freedom that we have in Christ in order to enslave us. And this is going to be the theme that runs through the whole letter. There's freedom and there's slavery. There's freedom and there's slavery. There's freedom in Christ, there's slavery under the law. And which are you going to get into? And what were the Galatians doing? 1:6 says what? I'm amazed that you are so quickly turning away from him who called you. So you guys are giving in. You're letting these people take your freedom in Christ away from you, and you're going, I'll submit to the law. And so the whole point of the letter is an argument stating, should we follow the law or should we follow Christ? Should we be slaves to the law or should we be free to do what Christ has called us to do and live in that freedom? Okay? So, let's keep going. Verse 5, but we did not give up and submit to these people. You'll see a lot of these. Paul takes shots at these Judaizers, never mentioning them by name. These people, we didn't give in to them for an hour, so that the gospel, the truth of the gospel, would be preserved for you. Now, from those recognized as important, what they really are, were, makes no difference to me. God does not show favoritism. They added nothing to me. So Paul and Barnabas go up to Jerusalem, meet with all the super apostles. Titus is like, we're good. And Paul walks away with what impression? Sounds like we're spot on. Sounds like we're doing exactly what we need to be doing. So on the contrary, verse 7, on the contrary, they saw that I had been trusted with the gospel for the uncircumcised, just as Peter was for the circumcised, since the one at work in Peter for an apostle to the circumcised was also working me for the Gentiles. Verse 9 says, so when James, Cephas, and John recognized his pillars, acknowledged the grace that had been given to me, they gave the right hand of fellowship to me and Barnabas, agreeing that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the circumcised. They asked only that we would remember the poor, which I made every effort to do. So how does the Jerusalem Council end? According to this, how does it end? Y'all are awesome. Just keep doing what you're doing. We'll keep doing what we're doing. Sounds like we're all doing the right thing here. All right? So everybody's in agreement. But Paul leaves with what? What's in his hand as he leaves the Jerusalem Council? This letter. And I think he can't wait to share this letter with the Galatians. So I think he goes back to Antioch. He sits down, writes the letter to the Galatians, and says, y'all need to understand this concept of freedom and enslavement, law, grace, faith, works, all these contrary things. Y'all need to understand this. So I think that's where he writes it from. But again, that's my opinion. All right. Verse 11, we get an interesting little narrative with Peter. Peter evidently comes up to visit. Okay? But when Cephas came to Antioch, all right, that's why I think it was written from Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. All right, now that's a summary sentence. Now, let's figure out what he did. Verse 12, for he regularly ate with the Gentiles. Whoops, you supposed to do that? Are Jews supposed to eat with Gentiles? Have you seen Fiddler on the Roof? All right, tradition. We don't go over there. They stay over there. We stay over here. We don't do that. So Peter is regularly eating with the Gentiles before certain men. Again, there's another hint at these guys. Certain men came from James. Now, where's James? James, the brother of Christ, is the head of what church? The church in what city? Jerusalem. Okay? So he comes from Jerusalem. Remember, the Judaizers were sent from Jerusalem out to cause trouble. All right? So these certain men, you could probably line them up. However, they came and he withdrew and separated himself because he feared those from the circumcision party. All right? It's not a fun party, or if you ask me. It's not a party you want to go to. All right? So then the rest of the Jews joined his hypocrisy. All right? That's a strong word. So that even Barnabas was carried away by their hypocrisy. But when I saw they were deviating from the truth of the gospel, I told Cephas in front of everyone, if you who are a Jew live like a Gentile and not like a Jew, how can you compel Gentiles to live like Jews? So if you're a Jew and you're following the law and you're eating with Gentiles, what you're doing is you're living like a Gentile. But when you get around other people, you go run around saying, Gentiles, you got to live like them. You're a hypocrite. And that's Paul talking to Peter. Now, does Paul get to talk to Peter that way? How does Peter feel about Paul talking to him that way? Why not? I mean, beyond just the hypocrisy thing, who is Peter versus Paul? Who spent 3 years hanging out with Jesus? Careful. Who did? Think about it. Who? Wait. Listen. Who spent 3 years hanging out with Jesus? Come on, think. Did Peter? Say yes. That's an easy part. Yes, absolutely. Did Paul?
No.
Possibly.
Well, that's true.
Arabia.
Maybe.
You see where that number comes into play? So that when anybody comes up and says, well, we spent 3 years with him, and what can Paul say? So did I. I spent 3 years in Arabia and Damascus, and I received the gospel from him. What did you do? Well, I spent 3 years with him in Capernaum and received the gospel. Well, it sounds like we got the same resume. That's why that was so important. That's why that number is so important when you look at that, so that they can be on the same page. So Peter kind of gets chastised in this moment, but is Paul right? Yeah. Who knew the law better, Peter or Paul?
Paul
did. It's interesting that the person who should be the bad guy in the story turns out to be the one that knows the rules better than the other guy. And Peter turns out to be the hypocrite. 15. We who are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners know that no one is justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. And we have believed, same word as faith, by the way, all right, in Jesus Christ so that we might be justified by faith. All right, now, in Christ, and not by works of the law, because by works of the law, no human being will be justified. You got three concepts there. You got works of the law, and you got faith, and one of them results in justification. What does justification mean? That's a big fancy church word. Some people say, just as if I'd never sinned. Maybe you've heard that before. All right. To be justified means you stand before a court and they say, not guilty. That person is therefore justified. Okay? So you can do it by works of the law or you can do it by faith. And Paul's argument is what? We know that no one is justified by works of the law. Okay? Now, later on, I'm going to make the argument that Paul, when he writes works, he's implying works of the law. But he stops short of using of the law, and he just says the word works. Think about Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. For by grace we have been saved through faith, not by what? Works, lest any man should boast. Can you put of the law in there? You see what he does? This idea of works, in Paul's mind, it's almost redundant to say works of the law. But he makes the argument early, and you'll see by the time he writes the Ephesians letter, his doctrine, his letters have kind of shortened up a little bit, like we would do just in a normal course of writing and thinking of producing these type of things. Okay, that's my argument. Again, I can't prove it, but you can't prove them wrong. So we'll just keep going. All right? So this is this track. You can go works of the law or you can go by faith. Works of the law or faith. And he's asking the question, which one is going to create justification? How much of the law are you going to fulfill? How much of the law do you have to fulfill to be justified?
All of it.
All of it. All right? You slip once, what happened? You're a lawbreaker. I think that's James. All right? Mm-hmm. Anyone? fails on one account is a lawbreaker and therefore is not justified. So Paul's making the point, what do you want to do? You want to follow this gospel they're telling you, or you want to follow the gospel I shared with you? One's by faith and one's by works of the law. Okay? So he continues this. But if we ourselves are also found to be sinners while seeking to be justified by Christ, is Christ then a promoter of sin? Absolutely not. If I rebuild the system I tore down, I show myself to be a lawbreaker. For through the law, I have died to the law so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. And my favorite verse is this, I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died for nothing. So he's saying, these people are coming around saying, if you'll just follow the law, you're fine. You don't need Christ. What they're saying is, if I can follow the law, why do I need Jesus? If I can do what you're telling me to do, then I don't need Jesus. Then Christ died for nothing. So he's really putting it to them in this argument. He's putting a lot of tension in here. Verse 3, or chapter 3, you foolish Galatians, why? Who? It's the bad guys. Who has hypnotized you? Before whose eyes Jesus Christ was vividly portrayed as crucified? I only want to learn this from you. And he's basically asking a rhetorical question. Did you receive the Spirit by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Works of the law or faith? How did you get the law? How many of these Greek Gentile believers, received the Spirit? Because see, it's a simple question. Were they following the law when they received the Spirit? No, not even close. Then you hardly know what the law was till the bad guys came around, the Judaizers came around. He says, so how did you receive the Spirit? By doing the law or by just receiving it by faith? The answer's obvious. The answer is very obvious to them. All right? Verse 6, let's jump down 3:6. Just as Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness, then understand that those who have faith are Abraham's sons, like father, like son. That's the idea in this culture, right? So you are Abraham's sons if you receive it by faith. Did Abraham follow the law? That should be a simple question. Did Abraham follow the law? It would have been a very hard thing for him to do because he lived 400 years before it was given. Okay? Does that make sense? Sorry, it was a bit of a trick question. Hopefully, I was hoping that was easy. He did what he got said, but he didn't follow the law.
No.
But he was Abraham. 400 years before, he received the promise. And this is the argument he's going to make. You, if you just have faith in God, just like Abraham did, because Abraham, God comes to Abraham and says, hey, you're going to have a son. No, you are going to have a son. And Sarah is going to be the mother of this son. And what happened? He believed. You know, bought the roses, got the Barry White album, came home. Hey, baby, we're going to have a baby. So, hey, he believed. And God said, that's faith right there. And I credit that as righteous. You are a righteous man because you believe in me. And he says, you want to be like Abraham? All you have to do is believe. It's not a matter of following the law. It's not a matter of doing all these things, right? He continues to make that argument. I'm going to kind of skip ahead because he's going to make that argument again and again and again, the works of the law versus faith. You can see, how far should we get in? Oh, I want to get this word in here. Look in 3:22. But the scripture has imprisoned everything, and by the scripture it means the law, has imprisoned everything under sin's power, so that the promise by faith in Christ Jesus might be given to those who believe. And what is that? How does the scripture imprison us? Because he's asking a rhetorical question. Why was the law given? What was the whole point of the law? If it's not to save us, it's not to create justification, what's the point of the law? And that's when he says the scripture has imprisoned everything under the power. So the scripture simply is pointing out our sin. Sometimes I'll say the scripture is like a speed limit sign. Right? Just because there's a speed limit sign up there doesn't mean, all right, I'm a good driver. The speed limit sign shows me how bad of a driver I am, or how illegal of a driver I am at times. All right? It just points that out to me. It doesn't mean I'm a good driver. Right? And so he makes this argument. First of all, it imprisons us. Right? And Paul's going to use the same argument in Romans 11:32. He's going to say, God imprisoned us all in sin so that he might have mercy on us all. So the law simply goes, hey, just want to let you know you're a sinful person. Just want to let you know you're breaking law. Just want to let you know you are not righteous. Right? And so we go, oh, then I need salvation. I need something. It was also a guardian. In chapter 4, he makes this argument. Now I say, as long as the heir is a child, he differs in no way from a slave, though he is the owner of everything. Instead, he is under guardians and stewards until the time set by his father. Okay? So it's making the argument that the law is like that guardian. It's the word pedagoge or pedagoge or tutor, right? This tutor is coming along and he's saying, you have to do this, you have to do this, because a child is not free to do what he wants, right? Because he's a child. He can't handle that kind of freedom, right? But the law is in place. And then at some point, the father will say, he doesn't need a tutor anymore. He is free to do as he wants to. As a man, he understands, he's mature, blah, blah, whatever. So Paul's using that sort of human argument or illustration. And then he comes back in 4:3 says, in the same way, we also, when we were children, were in slavery under the elemental forces of the world. And he's speaking to Jewish people, I believe, here, by saying those elements, those laws, those Ten Commandments, that we knew those are the things we were not supposed to do. For when the time came to completion, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law. Remember he said, through the law, I died to the law so that I might live for God. So he's saying, here was the argument, born under the law to redeem those under the law so that I might receive adoption as sons. All right? And because you are sons, God has sent the spirit of his son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you're no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. And that's the key, the heir of salvation. The heir of justification. All right. Keep going with 8. We'll keep reading a little bit here. I'm doing fine on time. But in the past, when you didn't know God, you were enslaved to things that by nature are not God's. But now, since you know God, or rather have become known by God, how can you turn back again to the weak and bankrupt elemental forces? Do you want to be enslaved by them all over again? And this 11 is just so frustrating. I am fearful for you that perhaps my labor for you has been wasted. Because remember, he goes on this first missionary journey. And he does all the stuff. Gets stoned, almost killed right there in Lystra. Goes on to Derbe. And he comes back and he's doing all this work for them. And those people come behind him. And it's almost like, why are you following them? I wasted my time. I wasted all my effort. All of this stuff has just been a waste of time that I did for you. And it's just a very frustrating thing for him to see this. I beg you, brothers, verse 12, I beg you, brothers, become like me, for I also became like you. You have not wronged me. You know that previously I preached to you because or through a physical illness. You did not despise or reject me, though my physical condition was a trial for you. Remember when he goes to Derbe? What does he look like the day after he gets stoned? What would you look like the day after you got stoned where they thought you were dead? That's why I come back to this story and I go, wait a second. That's what he's talking about. I'm preaching and I got an eyeball hanging out and ears cut and I'm bleeding everywhere and I just look messed up. But you did not despise me or reject me, though my physical condition was a trial or a test for you. On the contrary, you received me as an angel of God, as Christ Jesus himself. What happened to this sense of being blessed you had? For I testify to you that if possible, you would have torn out your eyes and given them to me. Which to me indicates that stoning idea. Have I now become your enemy by telling you the truth? Watch this, 17. They, bad guys, all right? They are enthusiastic about you, but not for any good. Instead, they want to isolate you so you will be enthusiastic about them. Did Jesus talk about that? Woe to you, Pharisees. You travel over land and sea to have one convert, but when you do, you make him what? Twice the son of hell that you are. this is what he's talking about. This is what Jesus is talking about right here, this proselytizing Judaizer. Now, it's always good to be enthused about good and not just when I'm with you, my children. I'm again suffering labor pains for you until Christ is formed in you. I would like to be with you right now and change my tone of voice because I don't know what to do about you. What kind of heart does Paul have for this church? Or these churches, rather? Do you feel the emotion here? You're killing me. I think I wasted my time with you. And you were so awesome and you were so amazing when I was with you. And now I feel like I don't know what to do. It's almost like they're teenagers, right? And you're like, what? How many times do I have to say this? All right? Y'all remember those years, all right? So, all right. Barely, all right? Looking forward to that day where I can barely remember teen years. All right? Let's look at 22. For it is written in Abraham had two sons. He's going to make another illustration here. One by the slave and one by the free. One by the slave was born according to the impulse of the flesh, while the one of the free one was born as a result of a promise. These two things are illustrations for the woman represent two covenants. One is from Mount Sinai. What do we get from Mount Sinai? The law. All right? And bears children into slavery. This is Hagar. Now, Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia and corresponds to the present Jerusalem, for she is in slavery with her children. But the Jerusalem above is free, and she is our mother. For it is written, rejoice, childless woman who does not give birth, burst into song and shout, you who are not in labor. For the children of the desolate are many, more numerous than those of the woman who has a husband. Now you brothers, like Isaac, are children of promise. But just as then the children born according to the flesh persecuted the one born according to the spirit, so also now. All right, now what did Ishmael do to Isaac? What did Ishmael, the son born to Hagar, born to the slave, all right, versus the one of the promise, Isaac? How did Ishmael treat his 14-year younger brother? What does it say? Y'all remember what the word is? Mocked him, teased him, something. And what happened? What finally broke?
After Abraham kicked him out.
Why did Abraham kick him out?
Abraham confronted Sarah about
Mama.
Yeah.
Mama.
Yeah.
Mama got upset. Some kid was bullying Mama's baby. And Mama said, you tell that lady to get out. All right? And Abraham did, because he's a smart man, all right? He did exactly what his wife told him to do, said, get him out of here. And so, yes, they were. And again, Paul ties this back in. So what does this tell you about the audience so far? Did they understand Jewish traditions, Jewish writings? So you had some who were Gentiles, but you also had a group in there that were Jews. So I think he's writing to both audiences, and he does this a lot in his letters. He'll include a lot of Jewish things, but also speak to the Gentile people. Almost as if to say, there's Gentiles in this audience, so Jewish people, mind yourself. Be careful. Don't go too far with what you're saying and what you're doing, because you're going to trip God's people up. All right? Love 5:1. Christ has liberated us to be free. I like different translations on this. Christ has set us free that we might be free indeed. Stand firm then and don't submit again to this yoke of slavery. Take note, I, Paul, tell you that if you get yourself circumcised, there's four consequences. Number one, Christ will not benefit you at all. Number two, you will be obligated to keep the entire law. Number three, you will be alienated from Christ. And number four, you will have fallen from grace. All bad things, right? You got to keep the whole law. You want to turn away from Christ? That's your choice. Now you got to follow the whole law. How you doing? Failed already? All right, never mind. You're out. You're cursed. You're finished. Sorry, you chose wrong. And that's kind of what he's setting up. He's setting up this idea that one is going to be really bad for you. Don't pick that one. Don't submit yourself again to the yoke of slavery. All right? For through the Spirit, by faith, we eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision accomplishes anything, What matters is faith working through love. All right? Now, I love the phrase here, faith working through love. That idea of working through is the Greek word energeo, E-N-E-R-G-E-O, energeo. Does that sound like an English word? Energeo. Say it.
Energy.
Energy. Or to make it into a verb form, all that matters is faith energizing love. So all that matters in Christ, the only thing that matters is me having faith, faith in the one that has died for me, which does what in me? Energizes me to do what? Love other people. That's all that matters. Oh, you got circumcised? Well, I believe that Christ died for me, so I went and I fed homeless people. Who wins? Who wins that one? Oh, you didn't eat shrimp today? Well, I believe that Christ loved me enough to die for me. So I went and I did this. I loved on my neighbor who hates me. I raked somebody's yard today. I wrote a note to somebody, tell them how much I appreciated them. Who wins? You see, the circumcision, it doesn't matter with Christ. What matters is the faith energizing us to go love people. That we recognize what he did for us. We get all that. We go, oh my goodness, that's so amazing. And it energizes us to go love. That's Paul's point. Circumcision, not circumcision? Doesn't matter. It doesn't affect anything. It doesn't strengthen anything one way or the other. The only thing that matters is faith working through love. And I think this is the point he's trying to make. Point he's trying to make is this is what it should look like. This is what your faith should look like. Faith energizing love. And you come back and renew your faith, which does what to your love? Re-energizes your love. So that's why I love that straight translation of that word. 7. You were running well. Who prevented you from obeying the truth? This persuasion did not come from the one who called you. Verse 9 says, for a little yeast leavens the whole lump of dough. Who says that? Who talks about the yeast and messing up the whole batch? Who says, beware of the leaven, or beware of the yeast of the Pharisees? Who says that? It's Jesus. He's speaking to his disciples, be careful. These guys will mess you up. All right? Verse 10, I have confidence in the Lord that you will not accept any other view, but whoever it is that is confusing you will pay the penalty. Now, brothers, if I still preach circumcision, why am I being persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been abolished. I wish those who are disturbing you might also get themselves castrated. This is why I think Paul's a pretty tough character. And he'll even say this, I'm pretty tough when I'm writing, but I'm really kind of soft when I see you in person. Which I kind of disagree with him on, because when he goes to, Crete and Cyprus, and first thing he does, he goes to the guy that's telling the counselor or the governor, don't listen to him. And he says, you're going to be blind. You're going to be blind from now on. He was blind. So Paul's got some strength here, but he gets kind of blunt here, and he doesn't play around, and he just shoots back. 13. For you are called to be free, brothers, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but to serve one another through love. For the entire law is fulfilled in one statement, love your neighbor as yourself. And he goes into this argument, there's works of the flesh and there's following the Spirit. When you follow the Spirit, you'll have faith and you'll love and you'll love and you'll love. And he says, now, let me show you this. The works of the flesh are these. You can see it 19. Sexual immorality, moral impurity, promiscuity, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissensions and factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and anything similar. I tell you about these things in advance, as I told you before, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, I would be careful to argue it this way. The works of the flesh are these, and those who practice these things without repentance will not inherit the kingdom of God. I don't think there's, I got drunk one time, you're out. All right? I think there's repentance to those works.
What is
but an unrepentant one would not have, Well, not inherit, yeah. What?
What's the word for practice?
Practice, right there, proso.
What's that mean?
Practice. It's a real simple word. It's a very common word, that you practice these things.
That continuing to
be continuing.
Repentant.
Yeah.
So that is the opposite of repentance. Because there are some people that don't want to, with a repentant heart, and they go back and they do something again, and they're like, I hate it, but I think practice is intending, planning to do it.
Yeah, I mean, we would use it. They practice homosexuality. They practice adultery. All right? We wouldn't say they practice drunkenness or any of those things. But we would say this is a lifestyle, a way that they practice and they live their life out. We practice humility. Right?
I think you could do that with drunkenness too.
You probably could, but we just don't say it that way. Nobody practices drunkenness. They're usually pretty good at it after a while. So they don't have to practice it anymore. All right. And he contrasts these works of the flesh with what? The fruit of the Spirit. Now be careful with this. It says works, plural, of the flesh are all these different things. But the fruit, singular, of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Right? So you may have one or two or three or four works of the flesh, but if you're living by faith in the Spirit, which of the fruits will you have? All of them. Note this. Note that singular versus plural right there. The fruit of the Spirit is that, like, mixed berry. All right, you got raspberries, you got blueberries, you got blackberries, all in the same, but it's all in one bag. And you either get the bag or you don't get the bag. Okay? You get all of this. And we should be demonstrating all of these things if we are living by the Spirit. Okay? Now, in most of Paul's letters, he has this break about halfway through. Right? Ephesians is probably the cleanest break. He has three chapters of doctrine, doctrine, doctrine. Then he has this break of, now this is how you live this out. This is how you practice these things. This is how you do these things. And in Galatians, we get a lot. We get five chapters of doctrine, and then we get one final chapter here. In chapter 6, brothers, if someone is caught in any wrongdoing, you are spiritual, should restore such a person with a gentle spirit, watching out for yourselves so you also won't be tempted. Carry one another's burdens. In this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone considers himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But each person should examine his own work, and then he will have a reason for boasting in himself alone and not in respect to someone else. Like I like to say, don't live your life looking out a window. Look at your, use your life looking through, looking at a mirror. You want to judge your Christian faith? Don't look out the window, look in the mirror. All right? And that's his point there. The one who is taught the message must share all his good things with his teacher. All right? That's a little bonus right there. All right? 7, don't be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, he will also reap. Because the one who sows to his flesh will reap corruption from the flesh. But the one who sows to the Spirit will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So we must not get tired of doing good. It's a phrase, it's literally a play on words. We must not kakos, kalos. All right? It means to sour or to harm that which is beautiful. All right? So we should not get tired or in some way screw up doing the beautiful things. We should not kakos, which is to harm or to turn on something, the kalos. So perseverance is his point on that. Must get tired of doing good, for we will reap at the proper time if we don't give up. All right? I always like to circle ifs in my Bible. Ifs are always very important words. They change doctrine very easily. Right? Therefore, as we have opportunity, we must work for the good of all, especially for those who belong to the household of faith. And in verse 11, look at what large letters I use as I write to you in my own handwriting. Some people think Paul had bad vision because he says, I write with large letters here. And generally, Paul does not write his own letters. He generally uses a secretary to write his letters for him. We'll see that on a couple of occasions. Then the guy will say, and I, Tertius, is usually the guy, Tertius wrote this for Paul. So it was kind of dictated. But this one, he says, look, I'm writing with these big letters, you know, so you know it's me. Because I was all jacked up and I couldn't see after I got stoned to death and all that stuff. So, all right, I'm tying a lot of things together. You don't have to believe me, Alex. The rest of it just kind of rolls out, very similar to what he's already said. Verse 15, probably the best way to finish it out. For both circumcision and uncircumcision mean nothing. What matters instead is a new creation. May peace come to all those who follow this standard, and mercy to the Israel of God. So that's the argument. And you know the context now. Now you've seen the doctrine. We've read through a lot of it. It should take you about 20 minutes to read through this. It's not hard. If you have the Bible Gateway app on your phone or something, you can push play and it'll read it to you in about 20 minutes. But I just would encourage you to go back through this, circle things, underline things, write all over this thing. I got 20 different colors all mixed and matched and notes out there. But just go through this. Go through this and read it, read it, read it, read it, read it. Next week we'll come back with probably just 1 Thessalonians. We'll separate 1 and 2 Thessalonians and talk about how we got there as we journey through on that second missionary journey. But again, here's what I want you looking for. I want you to look for Paul's theology to mature and his doctrine to mature over the letters. This was probably written somewhere in the 51, 52, and his last letters are going to be written probably a decade later. So I think if you look closely, and I'll try and point out, you'll see the maturity or the maturation of his doctrine, of his theology, of himself as a person, as we all do. Because he was probably about my age when he wrote the Galatian letter, and he's going to die at about 64, 65 years of age. So, all right? Good. Thanks for paying attention. Let me speak a blessing over us. Let's pray. Father, thanks for this time. I just thank you for preserving this letter, for keeping it safe from harm, safe from just being lost, safe from the people that wanted to destroy it. So many thousands and thousands of people would love nothing more than to have destroyed this letter so that we could have never seen it or read it. Father, I pray that we would cherish it as such, that we would see it as something that you have preserved for us so that we can understand the freedom that we have in you, in your Son, the freedom and the opportunity to love other people without feeling like we have to check boxes and fill in blanks and do all the small things, because we know that your Son fulfilled the law for us. Finished the law, completed the law, so that it is not something that we have to follow any longer, but we simply get to follow the love of your Son. And I pray that you will instill that in us so that we would live beautiful lives of believing, have faith, and that it would energize us to love every single person we meet with every single fiber of our being. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Yes. Let's see.